Hey friends, in a time that is riddled with security breaches, privacy violations, and data misuse, people want more control over their digital information and their online identities. Danny Strokis is here to talk about how blockchain technology might offer a solution using a new paradigm called decentralized identity. I'm going to learn all about it today on Azure Friday. Hey friends, I'm Scott Hanselman and it's Azure Friday. How are you, sir?
I'm great, thanks for having me.
So I've been doing all my passwords in plain text. That's cool, right?
All good here. Not the identity cop.
So it's a complicated world, and identity space is hard to cover in an episode of Azure Friday, much less in an entire 40-hour workshop on how to do identity. And modern identity changes. You know, the hotness was OpenID, and then it's OAuth, and then tomorrow it's something else. Mm-hmm. Are we searching for solutions? Do we understand the problem?
I think we're more just exploring possibilities and looking at new technology that become available and how we can apply them to age-old problems over and over again.
Mm-hmm. And what is ultimately the age-old problem?
Proving your identity on the internet in a secure way that helps you keep your credentials and your information private. I think that's the summary.
Right, and the idea is that we need to be secure, but we also want it to be convenient.
That's the age-old trade-off, right?
And I'm frustrated that right now we're in the age, I think, of biometrics, mm-hmm. whereas we think that, well, it is inconvenient to keep looking at your phone or touching your phone or touching your computer, but at least you always have your face and your fingers.
Yeah, I think people go two ways on that discussion.
Right.
Yeah.
But for me, as I log into my work machine, I'm thinking to myself, it's still me. I'm still here. It's the same machine. I haven't moved house. My IP address, like, so many things haven't
right.
changed, and you threaten me dozens of times a day that it might not be me.
It seems counterintuitive or unnatural, doesn't it?
But you're imagining a world that maybe doesn't even have passwords.
Exactly. So today, if you're building an application, any sort of user-facing application, right, you have to authenticate users at some point. Mm-hmm. And the status quo of how you do authentication is with a username and password or maybe with a social identity like Facebook or Google, right? Mm-hmm. And there's Azure services out there that can help you add support for those two things into your application. You can use Azure AD B2C, you can use Azure App Services, right? There's some built-in functionality there. Mm-hmm. But no matter how you implement your authentication, I think those two forms of credentials have some drawbacks. And the drawbacks with passwords are pretty well documented at this point, right? They're like hard to remember, you have way too many of them, they become a pretty popular attack for security target for attackers. And the problems with social identities are maybe a little less clear. There's a lot of great benefits to using a social identity to log into an application, right? It's convenient. You only have to remember one password. You're generally logged in with your Google or your Facebook or maybe your Microsoft account on your device already, so you get to SSO. You only have to consent to get into an application. But more and more, I feel like we're hitting the limit of where people are comfortable using their social identities to log in. Like, personally, at least, I'm not too excited about using a social account to log into my bank account, for instance, right? And I think people are also interested in exploring new ways of logging in because they're not really comfortable with some of the behavior tracking that comes along with using one of their social identities to log into things.
Yeah.
So we are here looking at new technologies, right, trying to explore the space, and we think there might be a way to achieve authentication and login and in an easy, convenient way, like you say, like social IDs provide, but with some of the privacy guarantees and benefits that you might get with something like a password. Because when I use a password to log in, I am establishing a relationship with that website directly, right? And there's no sort of like middleman or intermediary between me and that website to log in that might look at my behavior or anything mm-hmm. like that. So we think by maybe introducing a little bit of decentralization to the picture, we might be able to get the best of both worlds. And I'm not going to show a demo of authentication, but I'd like to explain to you how it works, if that's okay.
Please.
So bear with me, it's a quick diagram. We're going to start this picture. I'm a person, I have a goal of signing into, I have a banking website depicted here, right? And I have what's called a identity wallet app, which is a new application that I'm going to install on one of my devices, and here I've used a mobile device as an example. Mm-hmm. The main purpose of this identity wallet app is to store a private key for me. And this private key is going to be my credential that I use to log in everywhere. Pretty standard so far, and we're not using passwords. Mm-hmm. Next, I'm going to do something kind of interesting, which is I'm going to take the public key associated with that private key, and I'm going to publish it onto a distributed ledger or a blockchain.
Okay.
Now, we're not, to be clear, we're not proposing of building a new public blockchain. We're not introducing a new coin and doing nothing like that, right? We're using existing blockchains that are out there, like Bitcoin and Ethereum. There's one on the screen here called Sovereign, which is an identity-specific blockchain that's been built. And we are sort of building on top of those and encoding a public key in a transaction that goes onto the blockchain.
Okay, so you need a database, you need some state, and you want to do it in a way that isn't a social company.
Precisely.
But I don't want to have an interaction with a website where I give them my text, my password, and they put it in plain text.
Mm-hmm.
So you're introducing an intermediary, except that intermediary is a distributed,
it's peer-to-peer,
albeit trusted.
Exactly. That's a great summary. And when I give my public key to that peer-to-peer network, what I'm going to get in response is what we call a DID, or decentralized identity, or decentralized identifier, I should say. It's a unique ID that represents me uniquely in the world, and it's generated by the ledger that I go contact. And I can use it, and nobody's going to be able to impersonate that identifier except the holder of the private key associated with that identifier.
Is it a proxy for the private key?
It is derived from the public key.
It is derived from the public
key. Yes, and that's how usually that's the case, and that's how we guarantee uniqueness of it. But I'll show you what I'm about to do with that identifier.
Great.
So I show up to a website, like a Contoso banking website, and I'm going to assert to that website that I am DID, decentralized identifier 12345 in this case.
Okay.
I'm also going to sign that message that I send to the banking site with my private key in my wallet app.
Right.
The banking site is then able to go and visit the public ledger, look through all the transactions in the public ledger, find the transaction corresponding to DID 12345, and locate the public key or keys that are associated with that particular identity. They can use the public key to then verify the signature and authenticate me and establish a session with me. And voila, I've signed into a website, not using a password and not using any social intermediary to sign in.
So in the past, mm-hmm. I might have my PGP key, which is in a centralized directory, and I would then sign something, a message, send it to you. You would then go and look me up using my email address rather than my DID.
Precisely.
And do the same thing, except that centralized thing is centralized and can be compromised.
It's a perfect analogy. The key differentiators here about using decentralized ledgers for this public key infrastructure layer are, one, when I put my public key on the ledger, the ledger is immutable, so nobody's ever going to be able to take that away from me. It's there for good. Two, if I want to make any modifications to that ledger, I have to sign a transaction with my private key in order to make modifications. So this thing is completely under my control. Nobody's going to be able to modify it except for me. And three, like you say, it's decentralized and public, so anybody can come read my public keys and reference them around the world.
Okay, and then I would even add 3A or 4, there's an app involved, which means PGP right now is hard.
Mm.
It's hard, it's old, it's crusty, and it requires a non-trivial amount of work with a non-trivial amount of complicated tooling. But in a world of apps and app stores and mobile devices that are ever present,
true,
you've simplified a lot of this.
If it's not usable, then nobody's going to use it, right?
So I lose my phone. Now what?
Yeah, so that dives into a whole subtopic that you and I could probably spend a lot of time on called key recovery.
Mm.
And there's going to be various different mechanisms. There's at least two or three out there being proposed. We're working with a open source foundation called the Decentralized Identity Foundation.
Cool.
And I'll provide a link to that later.
Mm-hmm.
There's various working groups in that foundation, and one of the working groups is specifically around the topic of key recovery. The option that people are most familiar with today is what's used in cryptocurrencies, which is you literally take your private key and you are able to print out 12 random words and write them down on a piece of paper and store them in a bank vault. And that's how people are able to recover their keys when they lose their phone. They get the 12 words and they type them into an app. Not particularly usable, so we're exploring more usable options, like you say.
And I'm totally familiar with that, using some of the different password systems that how you do that. And I do, in fact, have that in my bank vault in a safety deposit box.
Yeah, exactly.
Which, again, as you point out, adds another kind of lack of usability.
It does. So this is signing into a banking website, right? Pretty
right.
Cool. But this is really only the beginning or the basics of decentralized identity. There's a lot more you can do with it. And now that I have this sort of identity that represents me on the internet, right? And by the way, there's in this application and in the tools that go along with your decentralized identity, there's a bunch of techniques that help preserve your privacy and make sure you can't be correlated as you use your DID from website to website.
Right.
But now that I have this decentralized identity, I can do more with it than just log into things, right? An identity that's just a credential and a unique identifier is a little bit boring. So what I might be able to do now, you could imagine, is maybe associate some rich information with my identity. Like maybe I could put my contact information or my preferences, like my shoe size, and then when I go shopping online, I can log in with my decentralized identity and the website can look up my shoe size, right? That's a simple example. But what's even cooler is that now other people, other businesses, and other agencies can now sort of make assertions or claims about me, and I can use those claims to go and prove things about myself on the internet or in the real world. And this can all be based on the same DID system. So to help explain more, I'll give you a quick demo.
Let's do it.
So let's imagine my name is Alice and I'm a student at a university. I am going to log in to, I'm gonna visit my same university portal that I always visit in my regular student life, and I'm gonna go to the student dashboard. Right, this is where I do most of my student things. And I'll log in quickly with the username and password that I've always used for my student activities. I'll log in and I see that the student, the university now offers me a new digital student card in the way of a QR code. And here on my device, which I'm mirroring, I've installed that same identity wallet app we just talked about, right? So I'm able to use the app here to scan a QR code. And what I'm gonna get in response is an offer from Contoso University to accept this verified student ID card. And the student ID card is going to be signed by the DID of Contoso University in this case. So nobody else was gonna be able to generate signed cards like this and issue them to me. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna go ahead and allow this because I'm a student of Contoso University and I'll approve it with a biometric. So I have this verified signed card sitting in my identity wallet now along with my private key, right? It's sort of like another credential, but it's specific to me as a student. Now I can roll over to someplace like a bookstore. Mm-hmm. And this bookstore is offering me a new promotion that says students receive a 20% discount. So they present me another QR code and I'm able to scan again. And importantly, I will be prompted with a request to view that same card that I just got issued from the university. Mm. I can go ahead and approve it and do a biometric, and my information will be verified on the bookstore site. And the bookstore can trust that this card that they've just seen is not fraudulent because it's signed by the university, and also that it was issued to me because I was able to prove ownership of the associated DID with my private key on my device.
Was your device connected in that moment when you hit share? Was that going up to the internet and back around?
Correct.
Okay.
Yes. It was signing a presentation of that card with my DID and sending it over the internet over some protocol, of the details of which are not important for this.
Right, but the circle was completed
yes,
at that moment.
It was. And so that's pretty cool. This is something that goes beyond just authentication into sort of claims exchange, and it's something that personally I don't think we would have ever been able to accomplish with just social IDs or a username and password, right? It's hard to imagine somebody like Contoso University being comfortable issuing digital diplomas against my social ID. But maybe they'd be comfortable doing it against an ID that's decentralized and that I, as a student, own and control. Mm-hmm. And so you can imagine this pattern being used for a lot more than just student IDs, right? You could pretty much use it for anything that you need to prove about yourself, like
right.
whether you're a resident of a state or what have you. Use your imagination. So I'm pretty excited about this. I think it can make a difference for people. I think this is one of the coolest things going on at Microsoft right now, personally, because it combines a cool new technology like blockchains with a meaningful mission of trying to give people ownership and control over their digital identities, and at the same time, maybe making the internet a slightly more trustworthy place through the exchange of verifiable information like this.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I get excited about. So this is all being done open source in a standards-based way, as is the par for the course in the blockchain community.
Mm-hmm.
And so we have a couple websites that you can visit if you'd like to learn more. There's a lot more that I haven't covered here. aka.ms/DID for devs is a good place to start if you want to learn about what Microsoft is doing and play around with our APIs, try coding something up.
Mm-hmm.
And there's lots of tutorials there. And then identity.foundation is the website for the Decentralized Identity Foundation where most of the project is run.
Fantastic. All right, I've got a lot to think about, and hopefully you do too. We're thinking about a new way to think about user authentication, decentralized identities, today on Azure Friday.